So thank you very much, Donata, for introducing this issue of the problems we are having here with heritage in this country. And I will take up some of your suggestions in my paper, which is about the changing roles of history museums in the making of citizens and communities, but in fact we'll talk also about the Italian situation. 2 centuries old, history museums have never been so vital as they are today, nor have they had so many visitors, numbers incomparable with those of best-selling history books. At the crossroads of research, the production of master narrative, popularization, and public history, history museums put the past on display, often shifting between a long-durée perspective and a retour de l'événement. More often, they shift between history and memory, a process in which Mnemosyne is more involved than Clio. National history museums are agencies for the construction of historical master narratives, which involve actors as diverse as museum curators or historians, and even politicians or communities and their leaders. They deal with complex systems of objects, looking for a balance between already existing collections and their changing significance in new, often profoundly transformed settings. And focusing on the nation, they can represent, or are silent about, all 5 different forms of encounter with foreign, non-European civilizations itemized by Jürgen Osterhammel as inclusion, assimilation, exclusion, segregation, and finally, extermination. They also play a crucial role in the politics of memory and to some extent in the complex field of trauma and memory. In short, they are crucial to us as citizens in a new age of globalization and of rapidly changing national, social, and political landscapes, as they are for historians concerned with memory politics and the public use of history, as well as with the profound changes in our societies. In their 2 centuries of life, the national history museums have changed profoundly. On the one hand, we had the museum system characterized by the sacred and by veneration, by martyrology and hagiography, by an assertive cult of the past. On the other hand, we have new museums that, in the most advanced cases, begin to be characterized instead by participation and multivocality, by the opening of spaces for debate and discussion that sometimes also involve grassroots actions. These are spaces in which the use of multimedia and the advent of oral history allow long silent voices to make themselves heard and once invisible subjects to be actually seen. Interactivity and the possibility to open windows on many different aspects of a postmodern reality fragmented and difficult to grasp according to the linear rhythm of historicism have given space to more inclusive, open, and problematic approaches. In these spaces, or at least in some of them, the watchwords are negotiation, dialogue, exchange, hybridism. In some cases, also gender. I cannot develop this issue here. However, it seems to me that in recent years, lip service has been paid to gender, but rather little has been done to use gender as a useful category of analysis also in history museums. Yet gender helps to highlight power relations and practices, reveal the national imagination, the limits of citizenship, interpretations of work and labor, the absence of women or of colonized others, the interest in private spaces or only in the spaces of power. And I'm particularly interested in understanding the strongly dichotomized representation of male-female role as shaped by nation building. I cannot go very much into this issue, but I think it is important when watching national history museums and history museums per se to ask questions such as, are women presented as just another stereotype of the national family and the domestic sphere? Are they only presented as the mothers of the nation, notwithstanding two decades of gender studies proving that a rough division between public and private spheres is largely unsatisfactory? Are women's political voices present, and how is citizenship defined through gender, social status, and race? Last but not least, which museums represent the nation of male and female consumers, as does to some extent the one in Reykjavik? We cannot go too much into this gender issue. Let's go back to history museums. They are very diverse, and they resemble, in my opinion, an open palimpsest evolving in direction which are not possible to predict completely. In Europe, we find a highly contradictory, sometimes decidedly regressive situation. This sector is undergoing rapid change, made even more fluid by the great interest aroused and the debates engendered by a number of paradigmatic cases. And for this reason, it is important to monitor what is happening, especially in relation to the theme of the nation and its implications in terms of exclusion and inclusion in regard to all cleavages and polarizations, but also to new challenges. There is consequently a great deal to do at European level, and specifically in relation to the theme of nationalism, which constitutes, let us remember, one of the focus of our UNAMUS project. Moreover, numerous issues are still unresolved. Primarily, the amount of space that should be allocated in these expository narratives to the work of deconstructing national myths of master narratives undertaken by historians in recent years. In this respect, it is useful to rethink the way some museums help in gaining a critical distance from the ethnic myths strongly encouraged in the early 20th century and, of course, in the 19th century. Problems abound. Hence, in examining the changing role mentioned in the title, I shall remain within a narrow chronology. I shall instead have to expand, at least symbolically, the geographical scope. The perspective must be quite wide, given on the one hand the intense transnational dialogue among museums, which extends beyond Europe, and on the other, the constant implications of various non-European realities closely intertwined with each national history. Crucial issues involved are colonialism and decolonization, migrations, the challenges raised by multiculturalism, hybrid identities, and the need to extend the notion of citizenship to immigrants. The most innovative and insightful analysis seems to me to have been produced in Canada, Australia, New Zealand, outside Europe.